day, everyone. I will be the first presenter of my group, the plumbing group, and I will be explaining what is plumbing and are the elements of plumbing. Firstly, what is plumbing? Plumbing is the art and technique of installing pipes and fixtures and other apparatuses in buildings for bringing the supply, liquid, substances, and or ingredients and removing them, and such water, liquid, and other carried waste hazardous to health, sanitation, life, property, also the pipes and fixtures after installation, etc. The plumbing system. Next, what is a plumbing system? The plumbing system includes all potable water supply and distribution pipes, all plumbing fixtures, traps, all sanitary and storm drainage systems, vent pipes, roof drains, leaders on downspouts, and all building drains and sewers. Now this is the water cycle of a plumbing system. First, the source of water, in which when you use your source of water, it undergoes a distribution system, which is your pipes, and it will come out to your plumbing fixtures. Wait for a minute, I will get my plumbing fixture. In which, if you see this, this is an example of a plumbing fixture, in which this is a faucet, PVC faucet, or PVC meaning polyvinyl chloride, the most common material they use. In which, after you're done with the use of your water, it's now called wastewater, and it will go to your drainage system, your system of pipes, and it will undergo, it will go to your sewage treatment part, and it will be called a treated water. It will still be in a drainage system because it will result your the system will be at a point of disposal where all hazardous or non-potable water is stored, in which a purification process is happening to get your natural water so that you can have a potable water again. What are the major components of the plumbing system? The system constitutes of the following: water supply and distribution system, plumbing fixtures, and drainage, waste, and vent. Firstly, it carries the water from the water source or sheet main or a plumbing to pump the building to the various points of use. Second, the plumbing fixtures or the receptacles that receive the water, building up to avail or use of water. A drainage, waste, and vent, the piping network within the building which conveys from the plumbing fixtures, all waste and rainwater to a treatment facility and the point of disposal. This is a typical plumbing system of a toilet and bath. So this is the septic tank, and this is the toilet, the sink, the showers, the toilet, and this is where the pipes or the plumbing system is called. And now, who is the plumber? The plumber is the one who works or engages the business of installing and in buildings the pipes, fixtures, and other apparatus for bringing in the water supply and removing liquid and waterborne waste. What are the different categories of plumbers? First, the apprentice plumber is a beginner at the trade who usually serves 3 to 5 years as a helper to the journeyman. A journeyman plumber has served its apprenticeship and is competent to perform the tasks of installing and repairing the plumbing system. And finally, the master plumber. Master plumber is a person technically and legally qualified and licensed to practice the profession of master plumbing without limitations in accordance with the RA 1378. Having passed the examinations conducted by the PRC, the Professional Regulation Commission has received a certificate of registration from the Board of Master Plumbing and possesses the current license to practice. What is the plumbing code? The plumbing code is a manifestation of the right of the government to regulate the practice of the plumbing profession based on the principle of the protection of public health. The basic goal of the National Plumbing Code of the Philippines is to ensure the qualified observance and the of the latest provisions of the plumbing and environmental laws. The first, it will be tackle the basic principles of the governed that National Plumbing Code of the Philippines. There are 22 basic principles of the 1999 National Plumbing Code, and the first principle as follows. Principle number one, all premises intended for human habitation, occupancy, or use shall be provided with a supply of pure and wholesome water, neither connected with unsafe supplies, nor subject to hazards or backflow or back siphonage. The keywords, cross-connection. It's any connection or arrangement of the physical otherwise between a potable water supply system and any plumbing fixture or tank receptacle, equipment or device through which enables a non-potable use or unclean polluted contaminated water or other substance to enter in any part of such potable water system under any condition. For example, I have a T-pipe right here. It's called T-pipe because it's a shape of T, and this is a GI pipe or a galvanized iron pipe. So cross connection happens here, the center, in which we have example. We have a potable water system going here and a non-potable water system, in which it will resort a cross connection here that it leads to a unsafe water system. Cross connection is where they meet. So this is next. Backflow. It's the flow of water or liquids, mixtures, or substance into the distributing pipes of potable supply of water from any source other than its intended source. So backflow happens usually at the toilet bowl because of the pressure rising up or when there's clogs. There are some ways to prevent this, but you shouldn't flush anything hard in your bowl to prevent backflow. Back siphonage. Back siphonage is a type of backflow where the flowing back of used contaminated or polluted water from a plumbing fixture or vessel into the water supply due to a negative pressure in such pipe. So the backflow prevention devices, some of these methods. First, the air gap water distribution. It is the unobstructed vertical distance through the free atmosphere between the lowest opening of any pipe that is conveying potable water to the flood level rim of any tank. So this is your lowest opening of your faucet or pipe, and this is the rim of your sink. So you measure from your rim of the sink and the tip of the faucet, and that's where you get your air gap. The atmospheric vacuum breaker is a device to use to prevent backflow or the reversal of the direction of the water against the direction it is designed of the system it is designed to be. The usual types of backflow for which a preventive method is employed to prevent are those that contaminate potable water with contaminated water. So this prevents it from mixing. A double check valve backflow prevention assembly. A double check valve is a backflow prevention device to protect water supplies from contamination. A pressure vacuum breaker backflow prevention assembly, PVB. It is designed to open when the internal pressure is 6.9 kilopascals or 1 psi above atmospheric pressure, so that non-potable water will not be siphoned back into the potable water system. And the reduced pressure principle backflow prevention assembly, or it's called RPZD, most commonly a reduced pressure zone device, is a type of backflow prevention device used to protect water supplies from contamination. Now, principle number two, plumbing fixtures, devices, and appurtenances shall be supplied with water in sufficient volume and at pressure adequate to enable them to function satisfactorily and without undue noise and under normal conditions of use. So you can categorize it into inadequate and excessive water pressure. You can call inadequate pressure when your water pressure is at least 103 kilopascals, and you can call it excessive water pressure when you have in excess of 551 kilopascals of water pressure. And now this is the appropriate pressure of each fixture fitting, which the flow pressure and the flow is measured. Water hammer is a pressure surge of or wave resulting when a fluid of motion is forced to stop or change direction suddenly. Momentum change. So imagine you have this water here. It's just water walking still. But when you open your valve, it's a moving water now. So all water is going there. But once you instantly close or you close your valve suddenly, it will create a shock, and this is known as hydraulic shock. This pressure wave can cause major problems from noise and vibration, and it will result to your pipe collapsing. The air chamber. Air chamber is a space filled with air, commonly act to act as cushion or shock absorber for equalizing the flow of liquid in a pump or part of the hydraulic system. Principle number three, plumbing shall be designed and adjusted to use the minimum quantity of water consistent with the proper performance and cleaning. Principle number four, devices for heating and storing water shall be so designed and installed as to prevent dangers from explosion to overheating. So, choose your heater wisely, or it's gonna go boom. Principle number five, every building having a plumbing fixtures installed should be connected to your public sewer system. All houses when it's at a reasonable distance. When you don't have any public sewer system nearby, another principle will show you what's the proper way to do next. Principle number six. Each family dwelling unit premises abutting on a sewer and a private sewage disposal system shall have at least one water closet and one kitchen pipe sink. Further, a lavatory, bathtub, or shower shall be installed for the requirement of sanitation and personal hygiene. Principle number seven, plumbing fixtures shall be made of smooth, non-absorbent material, free from concealed fouling surface, and shall be located in ventilated enclosures. Principle number eight, the drainage system shall be designed, constructed, and maintained to safeguard against fouling, deposit of solids, clogging, and with adequate clean outs so arranged that the pipes might be readily cleaned. So you should design your pipe system, plumbing system, that you can easily clean when you have any problems encounter in the future. Principle number nine, all piping and plumbing system shall be of durable non-pop proof materials. Non-pop means the National Association of Master Plumbers of the Philippines. National Master Plumbers Association of the Philippines. Yes, right. It's a free from defective workmanship and designed and constructed by master registered master plumbers to ensure satisfactory service. Principle number 10, each fixture directly connected to the drainage system shall be equipped with a water seal trap. And if you are curious what is a trap, this is the trap. This is called a P trap because it resembles like a P. See, there is water or non-potable water here because drainage system. The water prevents air here from coming out. It acts like a cushion for any unwanted air pressure. Principle number 11, the drainage piping system shall be designed to provide adequate circulation of free air from siphonage, aspiration, or forcing of trap seals under ordinary use. Principle number 12, vent terminal shall extend to the outer air and installed to preempt clogging and the return of foul air to the building. This vent terminal is usually place at the roof, because no one can get the stench of the pipes. Plumbing system shall be subjected to such tests to effectively disclose all leaks and defects in the workmanship. So here, the testing media of the piping and plumbing drainage painting system shall be tested with water or air. The water test shall be applied to the drainage and vent system either in its entirety or in sections. The water shall be kept for at least 15 minutes before inspection starts. So water is put to pipes for 15 minutes, at least 15 minutes before inspection starts, to see if it's clogging or not. Leaking. The air test shall be made by attaching an air compressor testing apparatus to suit any suitable opening, and after closing all other inlets and outlets of the system, air is forced into the pipe system until there is a uniform gauge pressure of 34.5 kilopascals, are sufficient to balance the column of mercury 254 mm in height. The pressure shall be held with the introduction of additional air for a period of at least 15 minutes. So it's like the water test, but instead of water, it's air they put into the pipes. Water piping. Upon completion of a section or of the entire hot and cold water supply systems, it shall be tested and proved tight under a water pressure not less than the working pressure under which it is to be used, plus 50%. The water for test shall be obtained from potable source of supply at 344.5 kilopascals of PSI. Air pressure shall be maybe substituted for the water test. In either method of test, the piping shall withstand the test without leaking or for a period of not less than 15 minutes. Principle number 14. No substance which will clog the pipes, produce explosive mixtures, destroy the pipes or their joints, interfere unduly with the sewage disposal process shall be allowed to enter the building drainage system. Principle number 15. The proper protection shall be provided to prevent contamination of food, water, sterile goods, and similar materials by the backflow or sewage. When necessary, the fixture, device, or appliance shall be connected indirectly with the building drainage system. Principle number 16. No water closet shall be located in a room or compartment which is not properly lighted or ventilated. So, if you want to take those good selfies, find a good comfort room. It has good lighting. Principle number 17. If water closets or other plumbing fixtures are installed in buildings where there is no sewer within a reasonable distance, this in relation to the principle number 5, where all buildings should be connected to the public sewer system. So, a suitable provision shall be made for disposing of building sewage by some accepted method of sewage treatment and disposal, such as septic tanks. Principle number 18. Is where a plumbing drainage system may be subject to backflow of sewage, suitable provision shall be made to prevent its overflow in the building. So to prevent this backflow, they put a flood tamer which prevents backflow or overflow of the toilet sink. Toilet bowl. Principle number 19. Plumbing system shall be maintained in serviceable condition by registered master plumbers. Number 20. All plumbing fixtures shall be properly spaced to be accessible for their intended use. So, space management. Take note. Principle number 21. Plumbing shall be installed by the registered master plumbers with due regard to the preservation of the strength of structural members and the prevention of damage to the walls and other surfaces through the fixture usage. The last one. Sewage or other waste from plumbing system which may be deleterious to surface or subsurface waters shall not be discharged into the ground or any waterway unless it's first rendered innocuous to some subjection or acceptable form of treatment. This means that you can't throw your sewage waste anywhere, and that's bad. Don't do it. And that is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening, and I will give you to my groupmates. And good day.
Plumbing fixtures and accessories. What are plumbing fixtures? Plumbing fixtures are approved type installed receptacles, device, or appliances supplied with water or liquid borne waste and discharges such waste into the drainage system to which they may be directly or indirectly connected. Industrial or commercial tanks, vats, and similar processing equipments are not plumbing fixtures, but may be connected to or discharged into approved taps or traps or plumbing fixtures as approved for in this code. So, what are the common types of plumbing fixtures? As you can see, it is listed below. There are water closet, bathtub or shower, bidet, lavatory, kitchen sink, and urinal. Plumbing fixtures, put in simple term, are receptacles or receivers attached to the plumbing system, other than a trap in which water or waste may be collected or retained for ultimate discharge into the plumbing treatment, which end point of discharge. There are common types. So there are common types are just what I said before: the water closet, lavatory, bathtub or shower, kitchen sink, bidet, and urinal. The next one is, what is a water closet and what are its types? Water closet is a plumbing fixture used to receive human excrement and to discharge it through a waste pipe using water as a conveying medium. Water closets are classified according to design, make, flushing mechanism used, shape, and installation. What are the types of water closet as the design? First is siphon washdown, second is the siphon jet, third is the siphon vortex, and fourth is the reverse trap. First, siphon washdown. It is the least expensive but the noisiest. Only small amount of standing water susceptible to fouling, staining, and contamination. Second one is the siphon jet. The jet, being submerged, introduces water underwater so that its operation is entirely muffled. It has a large amount of standing water to prevent fouling. Third is the siphon vortex. This type of bowl develops its flushing action through the water entering the diagonal holes around the rim, which creates a swirling action which forms a vortex in the center. And the last one is the reverse trap. The trap, way located at the rear, eliminated the bulge at the front. The design of the bowl plus its large water area and quietness in operation makes it desirable than the siphon washdown. So, what are the type of water closets as to make? First is the one piece, second is the close coupled, third is the pail flush, fourth is the squat bowl. So, what we use in our house is usually the close coupled. Some only use the one piece and the pail flush, and rarely squat bowl is rarely used nowadays. One piece water closet. So the water closet fixture is manufactured with a bowl and the flush tank molded into a single unit. So as you can see in the diagram, that it has is very different from what we see in the next diagram that we will be about to discuss. So as you can see, this is the second one that we will discuss. So this is a close coupled water closet. As you can see, it is very common to see it in our house. It is a water closet wherein the flush tank is separate but is attached to the toilet bowl. It is a two-piece model. So yes. So the third one is the pail flush closet. A water closet comprising only a bowl without a flush tank Flushing action is obtained only through water poured from a pail or bucket. This is used in areas where running water system is not available. So, kanija lahi ni siya sa duha kay tungod kanang wala siya yung flushing system because yeah, magamit kanin siya sa mga areas na walay running water system. Usually, naano siya makitaan sa mga probinsya. So, the squat bowl water closet. A water closet that is otherwise known as Eastern type water closet since the user assumes a squatting position rather than a sitting position. So, as you can see in the diagram, it is clearly seen that when you use this, you have to squat down. So, what are the types of water closets? As to flushing mechanism used, there are two types. So, these are the flush tank and the flush valve. So, the flush tank holds a supply of water for flushing the water closet. It flushes 3 to 6 liters. As you can see in the diagram, this flush tank stores the water and this will be used to be flushing some of the waste that will be going down under the bowl. So the flush valve is a design to supply a fixed quantity of water for flushing purposes. It is activated by direct water pressure without the use of a flush tank. It requires a flow pressure of 69 to 138 kilopascal. So usually, makita ninyo sa eskwelahan, malls, restaurants. And it is very different from the other one, the flush tank. As you can see, this is more tawagin na yun ng mas makasave ka ni kisa ito sa akin tungod fixed quantity of water ay mong magamit well sa katuos sa akin 3 to 6 liters muhang magamit. So what are the type of water closets as to shape? There are two types, the round front and the elongated front. The round front water closet is intended for installation in limited space, while the elongated front is more comfortable but occupies a larger space. Water closet bowls for public use shall be the elongated type. So what are the types of water closets as to installation? There are two types, freestanding or floor mounted. And wall hung or wall mounted, shown in the diagram below. What are the minimum clearances and roughing ins for water closets? Clearances are minimum distances of fixtures for human safety and comfort. Roughing in is the installation of all piping and fitting parts of the plumbing system, which can be completed prior to the installation of fixtures and accessories. Just refer to the diagram that is being seen. So, this is the first part where clearances are minimum distances of fixtures for human safety and comfort. Well, this is the roughing in. What is a lavatory and what are its types? A lavatory is a fixture designed to the washing of the hands or face. It is also known as wash basin. The four types of lavatory are wall hung lavatory, pedestal lavatory, countertop lavatory. There are two types of countertop lavatory, the over counter or countertop and the under counter. The fourth one is the one piece lavatory. As you can see, this these are the different types of lavatory: the wall hung lavatory and the deep desktop lavatory. And the counter type lavatory, the over counter. These are the three types of the counter type lavatory: the over counter lavatory and the under counter lavatory.
Continuation of the different kinds of lavatories. This is a one piece lavatory. It has a countertop, and it is integrated with the lavatory. It is commonly used in restrooms, but in all restrooms. What are the minimum clearances and roughing ins for lavatories? These are the minimum clearances and rough-ins. What is a bathtub? A bathtub is a tub for bathing, usually a fixed plumbing installation designed for one person. It is available mostly in the left outlet and right outlet. So this is the bathtub. What is a shower bath? A shower bath is an apparatus for spraying water on the body, usually from above, where a drain is through the shower bath floor drain. This is a kitchen sink. It is a plumbing fixture consisting of a basin with a water supply connected with a drain and is used for washing dishes or cleaning ingredients used for cooking. So these are the types of kitchen sink you will see in different kitchens. What is a bidet? A bidet is a plumbing fixture used for washing the middle part of the body, especially the genitals. It is also known as the SIDS bath. The bidet is used in tandem with the one-piece water closet or integrated with a close-coupled water closet. What is a urinal? These are the types of urinals. The definition of a urinal is a plumbing fixture equipped with a water supply and drain for flushing away urine. These are the different types: the wall-hung urinal, the pedestal urinal, and the stall urinal, and also the trough urinal. Wall-hung urinal is commonly used in public bathrooms or in public buildings such as malls, offices, and hotels. This is a stall urinal used in isolated public bathrooms. This is the pedestal urinal. Urinal types, clearances, and roughing ins. So these are the clearances and roughing ins of the urinals. What are other types of plumbing fixtures? So first is the slop sink. It is a deep sink set low and used by janitors for emptying pails of dirty water and mop cleaning. The second is the laundry tub. This is a deep wide sink used for washing clothes. A scrub sink is a plumbing fixture used, usually located in the OR in a hospital to enable personnel to scrub their hands prior to a surgical procedure. The hot and cold water supply is activated by any action mixing valve or by wrist or pedal control or by automatic sensors. And this is a drinking fountain. It is a plumbing fixture consisting of a shallow basin together with a water jet designed to provide potable water for human consumption. What is a plumbing unit? It is a minimum standard quantity of plumbing fixtures that discharges waste into a plumbing installation, including a water meter, one kitchen sink, a water closet, a laundry tray, a one lavatory, three floor drains, one shower head, and four faucets or a drain for a bathtub or shower stall. What are plumbing accessories? So the different plumbing accessories are the soap holder, which is this, paper holder, toothbrush and tumbler holder, towel bar post, and seat cover. What is a plumbing appliance? A plumbing appliance is any one of a special class of device or equipment intended to perform a special plumbing function. Its operation and or control may be dependent upon one or more energized components such as motors, controls, heating elements, and pressure temperature sensing elements. What is a plumbing appurtenance? is a manufactured device or a prefabricated assembly or on-the-job assembly of component parts and serves as adjunct to the basic piping system and plumbing fixtures. It demands no additional water supply, nor does it add any discharge load to a fixture or the drainage system. It performs some useful functions in the operation, maintenance, servicing, economy, or safety of the plumbing system. That is all. Thank you.
Guys, I'll be reporting about plumbing fixtures, clearances, roughing in, dimensions, and fixture unit values. So, let's start. Plumbing fixtures. So, water closet bowls for public use shall be elongated bowl types equipped with open front seats. So, for public use, it is recommended that it should be elongated. So, it should be elongated for hygienic purposes. Most probably for women. So, roughing in. It's the installation of all pipings and fitting parts of the plumbing system. And it also means to bring in the various lines like plumbing pipes, ductwork, electrical conduit to the space, but not make the final connections. For plumbing, this would be the pipes in the walls and the floors that lead to the sinks, bath, toilets, etc., but not actually hooking up those fixtures. So it's like temporarily placing them into their rightful places. So this is the roughing in for water closet. As you can see in the first diagram, first picture, the center of the bowl is 375 millimeter away from the wall and has a 750 millimeter distance away from the flange flush. So this is the flange flush. And it also has 457 millimeters away from the front of the bowl to the one wall. So this is the placement of the discharge and the supply line. Water closet roughing in. So this is another dimensions for the roughing in. And as you can see, the table is has kanang each like a code, like K87336. It symbolizes it represents a specific model for a toilet. So this is a anatomy of a water closet. As you can see, there's a compression washer, tubing, couple nut, compression nut, furl, and etc. These are essential for the water closet to work properly. And these are tank fittings of each different model, the SF10 and the SF12. Another anatomy of water closet. This is the float and the float rod. And it's the supply shock and the supply shut of valve. The supply shut of valve in the closet flange center line. So these are more anatomy and different types of models of a water closet. Classifying from the bowl to the toilet seat to the trip lever assembly, the float valve, the lid. Yeah. So floor drains. So floor drains are plumbing fixtures. A plumbing fixture is an exchangeable device which can be connected to a plumbing system to deliver and drain water. So floor drains are plumbing fixtures. So mo pagawas la or water or mo drains lag water. So So floor drains are for draining water, shower receptors, plumbing fixture, which is to drain water. Each shower receptor shall be an approved type and be constructed to have a finished dam, curb, or threshold, which is at least 25.4 millimeter lower than the outside floor at the sides and the back of such receptor. In no case shall any dam of threshold be less than 51 millimeter nor more than 228 millimeter in depth. When measured from the top of the dam or threshold or to the drain, yeah, so those are approved type of how to construct shower receptors. Wait, so there should be a minimum of 559 millimeter wide door. So these are essential dimensions to be followed for your shower receptor to be approved. So shower or bathtub, these are dimensions for a shower stall. And see, as you can see, there should be 24 inches clearance in front of opening from the wall of the shower stall to the to prevent the door from not being open wide. This one's for the bathtub. As you can see, there are proper placement and dimensions for each shower accessories or toilet accessories. This is to provide comfort and convenience while taking a bath. So this is for the shower. Shower faucet should be 400 to 600 from the ground. Shower head should be 1,900 millimeters. From a female, 1,800, child, 1,800. This is to prevent people from getting hit by the shower head and the shower valve. Plumbing accessories. So as what I've said earlier, these are the dimensions for lavatory accessories or plumbing accessories. It's to provide convenience and comfort. Kanang dili kay kamo reach out or like kanang duol ra kay nimo if ever kailangan nimo gamiton. So this is the toilet for disabled. As you can see, there are like railings at the side of the toilet and here at the side of the urinal. This is to prevent accidents or like the this is to serve as support for the disabled so they have something to hold on to while taking a bath or taking a poop or something. So this is the shower of disabled. At the sides you can see the handrails. So this is a toilet or powder room plan. In the two fixture plan parallel, the water closet or the bowl is placed right beside the sink, and they should have a 100 millimeter distance away from each other. And the bowl also has a 100 millimeter distance away from the wall. Same also for the sink, 100 millimeters. The two fixture plan across the sink and the bowl are placed right across at each other. So there should be a 533 millimeter distance between the sink and the front of the bowl. This to have a clearance for the person. So from the open type, as you can see, there are no dividers from the sink to the toilet bowl and the sink to the bathtub. So this is the open type. And from the compartment type, as you can see, there are dividers or like a partition wall between the sink and the bowl and the sink from the bathtub or like shower room. So the compartment for the toilet bowl should have a 736 millimeter wide and 1524 millimeter length. And from in the shower room or the bathtub should have a 794 millimeter width. So this is the difference between open type and compartment. The compartment has a divider. Fixture unit. A fixture unit is an arbitrary quantity in terms of which the load producing effects or water requirements in the plumbing system of different kinds of plumbing fixtures are expressed in some arbitrarily chosen scale. One fixture unit is equivalent to a rate of flow at 28.3 liters per minute or 1 cubic feet per minute or 7.5 grams per minute. A drainage fixture unit is a numerical weighing factor to account for the probable discharge into the plumbing drainage system by various types of plumbing fixtures. Using the single lavatory as equivalent to 1 DFU. So a single lavatory is equivalent to 1 DFU. Water supply fixture unit. It's a numerical weighing factor to account for the water demand of various plumbing fixtures. Using the lavatory for private use as equivalent to 1 water supply fixture unit. So this is a drainage fixture unit values for various types of plumbing fixtures. So a closed washer standpipe has a drainage fixture unit value of 2. Bathroom group with 6, bathtub with 2, bidet 2, dishwasher 2. As you can see, a bathroom group has a bigger drainage fixture unit value since there is a more water used while taking a bath or in a bathroom. So the more water that will be used, the more drainage fixture value. Bathroom fixtures may be grouped together for a total of 6 DFU, less than the sum of the parts. A bathroom group is defined as a toilet, bidet, lav, and tub or shower all on one floor level, so that's why it has a bigger drainage fixture unit value. So this is a maximum fixture unit loading and maximum length of excreta, drainage, and vent piping. So notes, excluding trap arm, except sinks, urinals, and dishwashers, except 6 fixture unit traps or water closets. So maximum units is these are first the 1 to 1/4 to 1 to 1/2. So these are size of pipes, like inches. The water supply fixture units. So as you can see, for public use, mura siyag padong na gid mahimo og like times 2 from the private use. Ang public use, like, pareha aning bidet. For, if private use, 2 ra yung water supply fixture unit. Pero pag abot sa public, 4. So, kini kay, we all know that if public use kay, mas frequent siya may use. So, manang mas like, mas daghan if ang water supply fixture unit niya. So, this is supply systems predominantly for flush tanks. So from sa usa ka water supply fixture unit, so there it has 3 gallons per minute, 0.19 liter per second. Yeah, sa usa ka water supply fixture unit sa 60, or there 32 gallons per minute, 2.02 liter per second. So let's see nasa atong sawayan, if lavatory, it only has 1 water supply fixture unit. So ang iyang gallon per minute ana kay 3, and ang iyang liter per second kay 0.19 liters per second. Yeah, let's see tatanang water closet kaning ang iyang flush valve kay 25 millimeters, sa private use kay 6. So it uses ang water demand niya kay 10.7 gallons per minute or 0.68 liters per second. So ang public use niya kay 10. So if 10 gani yung load in water supply fixture unit, kay ang gallon per minute magamit kay 14.6. Niya yung liter per second na demand niya kay 0.22. So grabe kay siya water demand yung gallon niya. So supply system predominantly for flush valves. I guess for flush tanks then ni kani for flush valves. Mama or then guys gamiton basta ang kailangan lang kay ang water supply fixture unit. Ara ra siya magdepende. Then you can really imo de makita kung unsa yang water demand ug yang gallon per minute, liter per second. So that is the end of presentation. Bye.
Plumbing and the fixtures. Let's now move on to the last part, or the last part of the plumbing discussion, which is all about water supply. So, it's about domestic cold water supply and distribution system. So we have 7 topics here, which first is domestic cold water supply system, domestic cold water supply distribution system, storage tanks, pipes, fittings and valves for water supply, plumbing tools for water supply testing, and water supply disinfection and purification. So I'll be discussing the first three: domestic cold water supply system, domestic cold water distribution system, and storage tanks. And my other two group mates will be discussing the others. So first, let's go to domestic cold water supply system. So what is this? It consists of the piping and fittings which supply cold water from building water supply to the fixtures, such as lavatories, bathtubs, water closets, and kitchen sinks. This is also known as water distribution system. So basically, it's understandable that it's all about water supply from the main from the main supply to towards the house or the building. So the elements of the water supply and distribution system. These are water service or house service, water meter, distribution main or horizontal supply main, fixture branches, riser, valves and control, and storage tanks. So the elements of the domestic water distribution system. Water street main, water supply pipe or public or community use controlled by public authority. So this is the main supply. In Cebu, the supplier of this is of the our water here is MCW. So next is water service pipe, the pipe from the water main, water meter, water supply system, or other approved source of water supply to the building or structure served. Water distribution pipe, a pipe which conveys portable water from the building supplies pipe to the plumbing fixtures and other water outlets in the building. Fixture branch, a pipe connecting several fixtures. Fixture supply, a water supply pipe connecting the fixture with a fixture branch or directly to a main water supply pipe. So this is the diagram. So as you can see, this one here is the water main, and this one is the main water supply that goes to the building or the house. So see here, water distribution, and the water meter for this building is found here. So the valves and controls. These are the I think this is for the lavatory and shower. So all of the water from that is used in the house comes from the water main. So next is the domestic water supply riser diagram. So this pipe here is connected to the main water supply, which is outside the house, and this pipe brings the water towards here, the heater, see, water heater. And this pipe, which is here above, is the cold water fixture branch. So the cold and the hot water is separated, but it comes from the main water supply and then is converted to hot or cold water from the heater. So this one here is the cold water riser. The house service valve, cold water horizontal supply main, this one, and this is for the hot water supply main. So everything comes from the water from the main water supply and towards the heater. So service tap connection details. Preparation cock, a valve screwed into the street water main to supply the house service connection. Gooseneck, the part of the pipe curved like the neck of a goose, usually flexible, also the lead connection between a service pipe and water main. Curb stop or curb cock, a control valve for the water supply of a building, usually placed between the sidewalk and street curb. Used to shut off the water supply in case of emergency or should the water supply of the building be discontinued. So this is an example. Here is the corporation cock found here. And the gooseneck connection, it's called gooseneck because of the formation of the connection. So wet tap procedure. That's the next topic. So the water main service tap. This is here in this one in the main water supply. So the corporation cock is here. A typical NYC DEP tap connection. So the saddle clamp is here inside the pipe. This is the main water supply pipe. It comes from the supplier itself. Service tap connection. This is an example of the gooseneck connection, which was said before. So let's move on to the meter connection detail. So I think this is obvious to everyone, and this is known to everyone. Every house has this, a water meter and a water stop. The water meter reads the is a mechanical device used to measure the volume of water passing through a pipe. So this is the water meter. You can see here the pressure that is being applied to the water, and also the amount of water that is being supplied. So the meter stop, a valve placed at the street side of the water meter and serves as a controlling device for the building installation. So this is the one that we use to stop or to control the water that is being being supplied to our building or to our houses. So this one is an example. So this one right here is a butterfly valve. This is the main pipe that connects to the main supplier, the supply manifold. So here are examples of the water meters of five houses or five buildings. Domestic cold water distribution system. General types of water distribution system. First is the upfeed distribution system, which also has the direct pressure and the hydro pneumatic pressure system or pneumatic air pressure system. Second is the downfeed distribution system, in which has a gravity tank. So this is an example of the upfeed water distribution, the direct pressure system, and hydro pneumatic pressure boosting system. So what their difference is, there's a hydro pneumatic pressure tank here, which helps the upfeed water distribution in the building. So next is the downfeed distribution system. This is an example of a downfeed distribution system of a building. So here is the basement is found, the controls for the system. And here is the upfeed pipe. This is the tank. So the water from the tank supplies the downfeed distribution of water in the individual floors. So here is the pipe. So hydro pneumatic pressure system. This is a pumping system that provides water within preset flow and pressure ratings, automatically on demand, giving all the advantages of city water supply. The system contains three basic elements: a pump of any type, a pressure sensing electric switch, and a pressure vessel or a pressure tank, which contains an elastic medium. So this is the hydropneumatic pressure boosting system. The pump is found here, and this is the pressure sensing electric switch, and this is the pressure tank. Booster pumps typical installation diagram. So this is the hydropneumatic pressure boosting system. Here is the tank. So this is just an example, a diagram of the booster pumps that is being used. Next, the bladder type pressure tank. So this is an example of the bladder type pressure tank. This diagram here is a hydropneumatic pressure boosting system using bladder type pressure tank. So this is the the main hydropneumatic pressure boosting tank, which is connected to a bladder type pressure tank, which helps him in boosting the water supply and the water pressure, which goes to the house. So next is the house distribution layout fixture supply. So this is an example of a restroom, and I think this is for the kitchen sink. So the shower connection, the water supply, water closet connection, lavatory connection, and the sink connection. So this is one pipe, and is this other pipes here are the ones who are getting water from the main pipe and distributing it to the to their individual pipe. Shower fixture supply connection. So this is just a picture that shows the connections of the shower connection. The shower head, the shower valve, and the shower faucet hood back. So next is the water closet and lavatory fixture connections. This one right here is the coupling nut part of the tank fitting factory set. This is the one found here in the below the lavatory, below the toilet rather. So here is a picture of what is inside this, what is inside the toilet. And also for the for the service connection for the lavatories and the sink. So here's a picture of what is inside our sinks, or what causes the water supply in our sinks. So next is the water storage tank. So the requirements for water supply tank design and construction. First is tank should be designed and constructed so as to be this watertight. It has vermin proof or rat proof. It is corrosion proof, capable of withstanding the pressure under which they are to be operated, the pressure of water, provided with safe and easy means of access for inspection. And next is number two, the capacity of any single tank or on building shall not exceed 113,000 liters or 30,000 gallons or 113 cubic meters. Third is tank shall not be located over openings, floor and roof construction. And fourth, portable water supply tanks and domestic water supply and for standpipe or automatic sprinkler systems shall be designed and installed to furnish water in sufficient quantity and pressure for such system. And lastly, the gravity tank shall be provided with the following pipes: inlet pipe, overflow, the drain pipe, outlet pipe, air vent pipe, manholes and covers, water level indicator, control valves. So this is an example of a water tank. So as you can see here, this is the manhole and the seal plate cover, the air vent with insect screen. So this is just an example. And here is a sink that can supply water to the one who is opening this. So the types of tanks. First one is the polyethylene water storage tanks. For hard water, deep well system, cisterns, and other fluids. So these are examples of the polyethylene water tank. These types of tanks are classified based on what they are made of. So the second one is the stainless steel grade 304 water storage tank. So as we can see here, it is made out of steel. So this is most commonly seen in the houses. And lastly, the stainless steel grade 304 modular water storage tank, 100,000 to 1 million liter capacity. So this is used in big buildings which consumes lots of water or has lots of people in it. This is used in schools, hospitals, and other corporate buildings. Next is the tank accessories. So this is called the float valve. A float valve is used to shut off the flow of liquids, normally water, at a predetermined level. So it causes the flow of liquid flow of the water to stop. Depending on which where you place it, float switch is a device used to detect the level of water within the tank that actuates the pump to turn on or off. So this is a typical installation of a tank with a float switch. So this is the float valve here with a float switch. So next. So the types of elevated storage tanks as the location of inlet pipe. So a floating on the line system. Water is pumped both into the tank and to the consumers. Water goes up to the tank when the water demand is low, or if there is a residual water supply, and water is drawn from the tank during peak demand. The system requires continuous pumping at low pumping capacity. So, and the other type is the fill and draw system. So, water is pumped directly into the reservoir, and from the reservoir, the water supply is distributed to the consumers through gravity flow. The source, the tank is usually installed near the water source to minimize head losses due to friction. So, these types of elevated storage tanks are classified based on the location of the inlet pipe. So, the inlet pipe for the floating on the line is here below the tank. I am in here at the center end. Yeah, and the inlet pipe for the fill and draw is here. It's located on a pipe beside the tank. So this is an example of a floating on the line system. This is an example of a fill and draw system. This is a water tower from Riyadh. So the water diagram for this is that this pipe here comes from the pumping station. It pumps the water upwards towards the reservoir, and then it supplies the water to the different house buildings and houses. And next is the water storage tank that only uses gravity. So the pumping station pumps water upwards towards the tank, and here is the pipe here. As you can see, this is the water. As it is stated here, water wants to return to this level. So that means the water in the tank will not go beyond this level, and that's why when it reaches this level already, the water is being pumped down due to gravity here, and here pressure is created, which is then being distributed to the different houses. So that's all for my presentation. I hope you learned something, and let's continue with the other presentations with the last four topics, which will be presented by my groupmates. So thank you for listening.
So since we talked about pumping stations and water tanks, now we're gonna talk about pipes and fittings for water supply and distribution. So what are the materials for mains, risers, and branches? The galvanized iron, or as you know it, GI pipes and fittings. The schedule right there pertains to the thickness of the pipe or fitting. There's also a schedule 20, which is the thinner version of the GI pipe. Same as this polyvinyl chloride, or the PVC pipes. The plastic pipes you can see plastic pipes you can usually see everywhere you go. So the third one is the polypropylene or the PRR pipes and fittings. So we're gonna talk about galvanized iron pipes and fittings. So galvanized refers to a metal plating process that coated iron or steel water pipe surfaces with a corrosion resistant zinc surface. So galvanized steel supply pipes are typically 1.5 inch diameter with a length of 20 feet or 6 meters. The connections are threaded. When the pipe corrodes, the rust accumulation inside the pipe chokes down the diameter of the pipe, resulting in poor water pressure. So as you can see in the picture right there, that's what happens when the pipe corrodes. So next, what are the types of GI pipe? Discard the left side. First, actually so short nipple, long nipple, and the closed nipple. So there's a couple, an elbow, reducing elbow, straight elbow, for a T, reducer, bushing, plug, gap, union. So the union has three types. It's the thread piece, a center piece, and the shoulder piece. 10 is the flange. 11th is the extension piece. So this is what galvanized iron pipes and fittings look like. So as you can see here, this looks like this is the plug. This is the elbow. As you can see, elbow, curve. Here is the external valve. Here is the elbow reducer. As you can see, it slowly turns into this small pipe, so that's why it's called a reducer. So the third, the sixth one is the T, the cap. I think it's a reducer, but flipped. This is the union. I don't know. I can't read it. And these three are the nipples, as I told you. So these are also fittings. This is the union patent. See here, there's a straight T, straight cross T, reducing T, reducing cross T. There are a lot of pipe fittings. So what you call a bushing. This is the flange. So you have to put the threaded part of the galvanized iron pipe so that when you put the bushing or in the flange, it won't. The thread will clamp itself. About the PVC pipe. Polyvinyl chloride, commonly abbreviated as the PVC, is the third most widely produced plastic. After the polyethylene and the polypropylene, PVC is used in construction because it is more effective than traditional materials such as copper, iron, or wood in pipe and profile applications. In the water distribution market, it accounts for 66% of the market in the US. So as you can see, the PVC pipes are the ones who are commonly used. So there is what you call the unplasticized polyvinyl chloride and the chlorinated polyvinyl chloride or chlorinated PVC. So these are what PVC pipes and fittings look like. So as you can see here, there are the normal size millimeters. There are sizes of the pipes and fittings. So as you can see, there's a coupling and cap, male adapter, female adapter, coupling red, water elbow, water T, threaded elbow and the threaded knee. See, this is what you usually see in in every building you can see. There's a coupling T, elbow 90 degrees, 45 degrees, trigger coupling, end cap, male adapter, female adapter, coupling reducer, T reducer, union, ball valve is what you use when you want to turn it on or off. You can cut the water source or you can, you know, let it flow. Foot valve, check valve, butterfly valve, and flange. So, a gimbal joint is a coupling designed to supply an efficient and economical method for PVC pipes. It is an ideal way for connecting pipes after removal of the damaged PVC pipe or connecting two pipe. We're gonna talk about polypropylene pipes and fittings. So a polypropylene pipe is used in many industrial settings due to its chemical and thermal resistance, affordability, and cost. The PN is what determines the thickness of the pipe. There's a PN10 and a PN20. So the PN10 is used for cold water piping, the PN20 for hot and cold water piping. As you can see, the thicker pipe is used in the hot and cold water piping. So as you can see, there are also ball joints. Is actually the same as the previous pipes that we've talked about, just a different material. The P pipes or polyethylene pipes. P pipes are made out from ethylene, which can be derived from either crude oil or natural gas. PE pipe is extremely strong, durable, flexible, corrosion free, and chemical resistant. These features make it perfect for a variety of underground conditions and help it last up to 100 years. The smooth walls allow for less friction with increased flow of water through the same diameter as that of other pipes. This is what a PE pipe looks like. If you can, recall from, I don't know where have you seen this, but I think everyone has seen these type of pipes. The big ones, the black, big black ones. So, this is the polybutylene pipe. Polybutylene itself is a form of plastic resin that was used extensively in the manufacture of water supply piping from 1978 until 1995 due to the low cost of the material and ease of installation. Polybutylene piping systems were viewed as the pipe of the future and were used as a substitute for traditional copper piping. The piping systems were used for underground water mains and as interior water distribution piping. While scientific evidence is scarce, it is believed that oxidants in the public water supplies, such as chlorine, react with the polybutylene piping and fittings, causing them to scale and flake and become brittle. Polybutylene water pipes are no longer accepted by the United States or Canadian building codes. So these are the polybutylene pipes. Copper pipes and copper tubing is most often used for supply of hot and cold tap water and is refrigerant line in HVAC systems. These are two basic types of copper tubing: soft copper and rigid copper. Copper tubing is joined using flare connection, compression connection, or solder. Copper offers a high level of resistance to corrosion but is becoming very costly. So as you can see, I think it is very obvious copper is really costly than the other plastic pipes we've discussed. Common wall thicknesses of copper tubing are type K, type L, type M, and type DWV. Type K has the thickest wall section of the three types of pressure-rated tubing and is commonly used for deep underground burial, such as underside walks in streets with a suitable corrosion protection coating or continuous polyethylene sleeve as required by code. It is color-coded in green. Green. Type K is green. Type L has a thinner pipe wall section and is most popular for use in water supply system. It is color-coded in blue. Type L is blue. Type M has an even thinner pipe wall section and is used in residential and commercial water supply where pressure is not too great. Its color is red. So K is green, L is blue, M is red. So type DWV has the thinnest wall section and is generally only suitable for unpressurized applications such as drains, waste, and vents. So I guess now you can know why it's called DWV. Drains, wastes, and vent pipes. So these are copper pipe shoulder joints or joint joints. This is a cut. This is a ream. Clean. Apply flux and assemble, light torch, this is what you use, a pipe cutter for the cut, about composite pipes. These are composite pipes. Composite pipe is composed of polyethylene, a bonding agent, aluminum bonding agent again, and polyethylene. So as you can see, composite pipes are like a hybrid type of pipes. So next is control valves for water supply. Valve is a device that regulates, directs, or controls the flow of fluid. By opening, closing, or partially obstructing various passageways, valves are technically fittings, but are usually discussed as a separate category. In an open valve, fluid flows in a direction from higher pressure to lower pressure. So the different type of valves found in plumbing systems are, one is, track valve. 4 is angle valve, 5 is the ball valve or stopcock, and 6 is the faucet or the bib. So, this is what I see. It has different parts. So, globe valve looks like this. As you can see, there's a part there called, I think, a globe valve. So a gate valve is a valve in which the flow of water is cut off by means of a circular disc fitted against the machine. Smooth faces at right angles to the direction of the flow. So while globe valve is a valve in which the flow of fluid is cut off by means of a circular disc that fits against the horizontal valves here. So this is the valve and the angle. Valve is a valve that automatically closes to prevent the flow of liquid or gas in a reverse direction. So a check valve is like for a one-way valve. So if anything goes the other way, it automatically closes. As you can see here, there's a like a hinge and a hinge if the water flows left to the right, it opens. So if any liquid or gas flows through So as you can see, there's a hinge right there. This is the angle valve. An angle valve is a device usually of the grid type in which the hinges and nails are at right angles. That's why it's called an angle valve. So next is the ball valve. A ball valve is a spherical shaped gate valve providing very tight shutoff. While next is the faucet. So the faucet, I think everybody knows what the faucet is. The faucet is a valve on a water pipe by means of which water can be drawn from or held within the pipe. The valve is placed at the end of the pipe. So this is the faucet. So these are other types of valves.
Talking about the plumbing tools for water supply. To start with, there are basic plumbing tools for water supply work. These are the pipe vise, the pipe cutter, the pipe reamer, the pipe stock and die, the pipe tap, the pipe wrench, the monkey wrench, the strap wrench, the chain wrench or the pipe tongue, the basin wrench, the open end wrench, the adjustable wrench, and a flaring tool. So the basic tools for water supply work are the pipe wrenches. So there are many kinds of pipe wrenches. The first type of wrench we're going to talk about is the straight pipe wrench. So the straight pipe wrench is used to screw pipes into or out dirty things. So the second one is the end pipe wrench. So the end pipe wrench assures a fast and easy grip for pipe working in restricted spaces or close to walls. The next one is the monkey wrench or the spud wrench. So this kind of wrench is used to tighten or loosen fitting with parallel sides or hexagonal ends, such as knots, bolts, and unions. The next type of wrench is the strap wrench. So this wrench is used when working with brass or plated pipes and fittings, since it does not damage the surface being tightened. So it is also used in places too small to admit a pipe wrench. The next one is the adjustable wrench. So this kind of wrench is used similar as the monkey wrench. So it is also used to tighten or loosen fitting with parallel sides or hexagonal ends such as knots, bolts, and unions. The basin wrench is spring-loaded jaw, provides fast one wrenching. The next one is the chain wrench. So this kind of wrench is used for turning pipes with 150 diameter and larger. The next one is a plastic nut basin wrench. So this kind of wrench is designed to reach and turn plastic mounting nuts on faucets, prayers, and ball cocks. So we're going to talk about the plumbing tools. So under the plumbing tools is the pipe vise. So the pipe vise is used to hold the pipe to be cut, threaded, or assembled. The pipe reamer as well is used to remove the burrs from the inside of the pipe or to enlarge an opening. A burr is a rough, sharp edge left on a metal by a cutting tool. The next one is the flaring tool. So the flaring tool is used to widen the end of a soft metal tubing, usually copper, to make a mechanical seal. Then the pipe tap. So pipe tap is used for making internal threads in GI pipes. Pipe extractors, on the other hand, make easy work of removing broken threads and threaded ends of pipe plugs and fittings. The next one is the pipe stock and die, the ratchet threader type. So it is used to make external threads on GI pipes. We also have here pipe cutter. So the pipe cutter is used for cutting GI pipe or copper tubing. Then the plastic pipe cutter. So its function is very similar to pipe cutter, but plastic pipe cutter is used for cutting plastic tubing. Then we have automatic threading machine, and we have the deboring tools, the inner and outer reamer. So in plumbing, there are general plumbing tools. These are the electrical drill, the angle grinder, the cold chisel, the steel tape, the folding rule, the anvil, the hacksaw, the level, and the different types of hammer, specifically the ball peen hammer, the ripping claw hammer, the curved claw hammer, short-handled sledge hammer, and the hand-drilling hammer. And we also have the vise, the thin snip, and the PVC ABS saw. So in plumbing, we also have this plumbing diagnostic equipment. This equipment is used in locating the plumbing line or where the tubings are located. So we have here the line locator and the transmitter. So personal protective equipment, these are used to protect yourself when performing a work, especially in plumbing. That is, in plumbing, we are using power tools and heavy equipment, such as and heavy tools. So under the personal protective equipment, we have the fall protection components, which are the body belt, the harness, the lanyard, or the lanyard for the shock absorber, the lifeline, the rope grab, and the helmet. For the eye and ear protection, we have the safety goggles, the earplugs, and the earmuffs. So testing the water supply system. So in testing the water supply system, we have the hydrostatic test. So these hydrostatic tests comes in two. First is a rough piping test. Rough piping test is subjected to a hydrostatic test at 862 kilopascal minimum for a period of 3 hours and should be proved watertight without any loss of pressure. The other one is the finished piping test, hydrostatic, which is the entire completed system, including all the fixtures and faucets, should be retested by subjecting it to a hydrostatic of 517 kilopascal for a period of 3 hours and should be proved watertight without any loss of pressure. Excuse me. So another type of water supply system test is the compressed air test for water supply piping system. So this kind of test is used by testing the pipes without filling water inside the tubing. With the compressed air, they're able to test the leakage of the pipe. So as you can see here, we have the air compressor. So this is where the air comes from. And we also have the pressure gauge. So if the pressure released by the air compressor is not the same as the pressure gauge, so it means that there are some parts of the plumbing or the piping system that has a leakage. So the disinfection method. So in disinfection method, disinfection of new installed potable water supply system, including water supply tanks, is required to remove objectionable matters in order to correct an unsanitary condition. So procedure which is all water supply connections should be disconnected, plugged, or effectively shut off to prevent any foreign matter or contamination from entering the water supply thereto. So the methods, we have two methods for disinfection. One of the following which method may be applied. So the first is that the system of part thereof shall be filled with a water solution containing 50 parts per million or PM of available chlorine and allowed to stand for 24 hours before flushing and returning to service. The second is a system of, or part thereof, shall be filled with a water solution containing 200 parts per million or PPM of available chlorine and allowed to stand for 3 hours before flushing and returning to service. So in chlorinating your well or tank, the first thing you need to do is to contact your well driller. If possible, to take charge of the actual disinfection, as he is more familiar with the mechanics of the deep well. The second one is that if water driller is not available, procure a disinfecting chemical called the calcium hypochlorite, or more commonly known as the ATH powder, or the high test hypochlorite powder, which contains 65 to 70% available chlorine, if given specification. The third one you need to do is to remove the top cover of the well before proceeding. Then make a super saturated solution of the powder by making it into a 1 gallon of water until no more of it dissolves. This solution is white in color. Then the fifth procedure is to pour the solution rapidly into the well and take care to flush the casing above the water level. Next is to let it stand overnight and next morning pump out the water in the well until clear water comes out and until there's no more smell of chlorine. The last one is that after the disinfection, collect another sample from the well and submit it to a laboratory for verification as to sufficiency of the chlorination. So to complete a rate of the powder to be used, grams of HCH is equal to dose times volume of container in cubic meter over percent available in chlorine, where the dose is equivalent to 50 milligrams per liter. Then the container refers to the well or tank being used, and the percent of available chlorine is 65 to 70%, depends on the ETH powder you are using. So some important conversion factors are 1 cubic feet is equivalent to 7.8 gallons, and 1 cubic feet also is equivalent also to 28.3 liters. So to compute the volume, pi r squared times h, wherein h is the depth of the well in meters. So the private water supply verification process. So majority of the treatment process used by the local water district or the public water supplier are not generally applicable to the purification of private water supplies. So the method used to purify private water supply for domestic use is the filtration process. So this process comes in 5 stages. The first stage is the sediment pre-filter. So during this stage, the dirt, rust, and sand particles are being trapped. Then the second stage is the granular activated carbon pre-filter. So at this stage, the chlorine is being removed. Then on the next stage is the stage 3, which is the carbon block pre-filter. So it removes most of the organic material. Then fourth is the reverse osmosis, where reverse osmosis is the movement of liquid through a semi-permeable membrane from a more concentrated solution to a more dilute solution. This is achieved by applying an external pressure to the solution on the more concentrated side of the membrane. Then lastly is the carbon post-filter, which is the stage 5. So at this stage, the odors and the gases are being removed. So here's the filtration process, as you can see in the presentation. Here's the stage 1, and then stage 2, the stage 3, the stage 4, where the reverse osmosis happens, and stage 5, where the odors and gases are being removed. So let's talk about the water softener. So water softener is an apparatus which chemically removes the calcium and the magnesium salts from the water supply, usually by ion exchange. So when water is heated, carbon is easily formed from the solution, resulting into hard scale. So as you can observe, if you try to boil your water inside your kettle, you can see some particles settling down. Those are the precipitates. Those precipitates are known to be the calcium and the magnesium salts. So this scale can reduce the heat transfer in the net cross-sectional area of the pipes, as well as it may corrode the equipment. So that's why it's very important to use this water softener. So here's the water softener cycle. And that ends my report. Thank you.